Spaceman. Loneliness, regret, gratefulness. This movie is probably one of the best movies I've seen in the past like decade of my life. I've watched a lot of movies in my recent years. I've recently become a sort of cinephile, if you will. And this is going to be my first kind of review on this channel. I really felt the need to start it off with something that was so beautiful and so passion and effort rich and filled. And if anybody can do that, I know it's Adam Sandler, because even his comedy movies are filled with just love and effort, and you can read that from any one of his movies, even his most comedic type movies with the dumbest premises, being able to control things with a fucking universal remote. He has very deep themes at the end of the movie, and we've seen he's been able to play this sort of lonely, depressed, in denial character that doesn't want to get help for himself and doesn't want to see the true shortcomings of his own life. You see, Adam Sandler is usually more of a comedic actor, but in this movie, he portrays a character who is almost unmotivated to help himself or deal with his issues. Like, he almost doesn't know how to deal with his problems. And we suppress and keep moving forward, never truly dealing with it directly, just always letting it affect us, but still doing the daily things we need to survive, to the smallest degree though, then isolating, only really communicating if necessary, staying in your room, staying in your bed, never really doing what's necessary. But the underlying uniqueness of this scenario is Jakob is completely and truly alone. And I feel like this movie acutely identifies how humans behave and act without truly understanding themselves as a species. And it's something that is largely known but untreated as a society, that mental health is a big issue that not a lot of people talk about, but a lot of people talk about. It's one of those things that just nobody really has the answer for, other than helping yourself or getting help for yourself. And a lot of people just don't want to do that. And this movie touches on that so beautifully. And not to mention the daily nuances of living in space and dealing with everything around him breaking literally and metaphorically and spiritually. And once his wife slowly recedes all contact with him, he starts to try gripping onto what's left of reality that once was trying to the best of his ability, the best of his depressed capability, to get back in contact with whom he was starting to lose. Having way more vivid and active dreams and daydreams of his taken for granted perfect life, or his perceived perfect life, or I guess his perceived imperfect life. I'm not sure. I'm not 100% sure why he decided to leave. As humans, we aren't 100% sure why we do the things we do when we do them. That's the beauty of this movie. And once those things are gone that we didn't understand that we needed or loved, we start to break and want them back and understand what we lost. As he starts having these more vivid and active dreams, something changes. He starts hearing somebody. And at this point in the movie, Jakob has been in communication with the, I don't know what you would call them. I'm just going to call them Houston because I don't know the name for them. That is who he's talking to mainly. And as the comms are going out slowly and he's trying to get more back into communication with Houston, he hears this sort of voice that in the movie, at this point, you don't know 100% if the character you're hearing or the person or voice you're hearing is real or in Jakob's head. And they beautifully do this by making you as a viewer want to make your own choice of whether you believe it or not. And I very strongly believe that he wasn't hallucinating and that what he was hearing was real.
even though there are instances of, in the movie of there being like scans or kind of like clouds, orange clouds they had to get rid of whatever infestations. You know what I'm talking about if you've seen the movie. If you haven't, watch it. It's a beautiful movie. It's on Netflix. But back to what I was saying, it just is so cool how you're able to have your own imagination of what the reality of the character is. And it's even said in the movie by the spider, or I don't really want to call it a spider because I feel like the directors had a different vision for the, like, obviously it's a fucking big ass spider, like we all can see that, but I feel like it is very, the word spider and the animal spider we have on this planet is nothing like the character in the movie. The character in the movie is a very high intelligence species that tells the main character, Jakob, that what he's seeing, when Jakob asks if he's real, he is as real as he is. So I feel like reality is as real as we are. It's as real as we make it. You know what I mean? And that movie touches on that subject beautifully. And I think it does that with a lot of different things. It's a beautiful guide into the exploration of human loneliness. And I really think that Netflix has a reputation of like putting out bad movies, but this was something that I marveled at, something that we should all marvel at. It was the Interstellar of our year, if you will. Without a doubt, the character Hanush, I don't know how you really say it. I think it's Hanush. I'm going to say Hanush. Voiced by our favorite Riddler, is a great representation of the idea of help, or help as an idea in general. The idea of you are not alone, and that asking for help isn't giving up, it is refusing to give up. And the main character in this movie can be replaced by a lot of us in this world, and it is a great representation of humanity's shortcomings and ignorance to them, how our perception of reality can be so narrow that it literally and cosmically messes up our whole life. And in the pursuit of a dream, we are willing to throw away everything, our life, our friends, our love, even our promises. And the movie takes that idea to the extreme with the quote, "Wherever you go, I go, and I go, you go." And we see Jakob break this promise like no one ever has before by traveling across space and time, literally without her. And it goes back to how a lot of us live our lives in general. Without getting help or seeking a better life for ourselves, we isolate and distance. And that's exactly what Jakob did, until she did it back to him. And our third main character, played by Carey Mulligan, Jakob's wife, Lenka, she is represented as a regret, ungratefulness to what we love, or simply just the things we lost and are losing by our own design. This movie puts a mirror to the face of us as a race and identifies our exact problem, the refusal of our own problems and the refusal of the solution to these problems. In the movie, Jakob is presented with so many options to fix his mental anguish he's been carrying around, and he denies it. He starts setting boundaries like one tends to do, although in this movie, he doesn't even know if his solution is just in his head or not. But I think I like that a lot, and like a lot of us, he slowly realizes that he is real. And I want to point out that even though the scanners couldn't find him, and a lot of the times it seems like he changes sizes in the movie, I feel like the representation of him as a spider in Jakob's mind is a portrayal of maybe a fear that he has in his reality. I don't know. I'm kind of improvising a thought process to aid my belief that Hanush is real because I love him so much. But back to what I was saying, the scanners
on the ship couldn't find him, and we know he's so advanced that he's able to observe humans from afar and travel through deep space and apparently solid metal, because he gets in and out no problem. But anyway, near the end of the movie, Hanush relents the skinny human and decides he's tired of Jakob like Andy and Woody from Toy Story, because he doesn't want to fix any of the problems that he has. He doesn't care. He just wants to keep being sad. And it wasn't until he truly realized he was all alone. No telecoms, no wife, no Hanush. That he broke and he realized what he had to do and what a lot of us need to do and get help. And the resurfaced and suppressed memories of his past mistakes brought to him through telekinetic probes by Hanush. Side note, I love how the daydreams or memories or the regular dreams that Hanush invades or like interacts with are all like in this fish eye or like spider eye type lens. I don't know if that's to represent Hanush seeing it also. But anyway, Jakob as a character acknowledged his shortcomings and his narrow, skewed perspective and mindset that a lot of us fall into, and he apologized to his wife truthfully and honestly. Not to receive anything or get her back, but to do what was right, because that's what she deserved. And this loving interaction actually brought Hanush back to also experience the edge of time together, the beginning and the end. But sadly, we find out that Hanush is dying and he wasn't truthful about his past with the Grompeds, who attacked his home. Regardless, they experienced the bliss and nirvana of the purple particles of time in a beautiful array of colors and lights, very reminiscent of Interstellar. And in the end, we sadly say goodbye to Hanush. And Jakob accepts his passing and slowly floats back to a ship that was owned by the Koreans that were slowly catching on Jakob's tail, apparently. Trying to do the same thing that Jakob was doing, gather the particles, study them. But anyway, when Jakob gets back on the ship, he is able to get back in contact with Lenka because they have a phone. And he says to her, "If I knew then what I knew now, I never would have left." And she says in response, "If I knew then what I knew now, would I have still kissed you?" And in response, he asks a beautiful question, "Would you kiss me again?" And she says, "It was a really good kiss." And with that, the movie ends. With all that said, if I had to rate this movie, I would do it off of four categories for this one specifically. The characters, the plot, the score, the cinematography. I would give the characters a solid 9.9. I would say a 10. Only thing I would critique is the fact that they chose a spider and it throws a lot of people off of the movie. But if I had to be brutally honest, I love it and I love spiders. I have a tattoo of a spider, so I don't really give a fuck. The plot of the movie, I would give a 10 out of 10. It was a beautiful story, beautiful meaning, and everything was portrayed perfectly. But to wrap up this video, I guess what I'm trying to say is that the directors of this film really put together a masterpiece of solitude. And if you're afraid of spiders, I really feel bad for you not being able to watch this movie, or if you have like arachnophobia, because this film, I think, can fix it for a lot of people. I think it can change for a lot of people if they're willing to just face their fears and give it a chance, like Jakob was in the movie. I not only feel very strongly about the plot of this movie, but I am in love with the score of this movie. Whoever directed the musical takes of this movie knew exactly what they're doing. And all I have to critique it is I wish there was more. And I want to listen to it on a daily basis. These scenes with this music behind it was ethereal. It was beautiful. There was nothing else like it. And the only thing I could pair the beautiful music with was the beautiful cinematography. And I think that speaks for itself. I truly and honestly believe some of the movies Netflix is coming out with should be cinematic releases. But
lastly, I just wanted to say thank you to Adam Sandler for the beautiful insight into the outside perspective of the problems no one wants to talk about or the things people deal with. So go watch this movie if you haven't already. And with that, stay sturdy, my friends.